Margaret, can you hear me okay in the back? Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Is that better, Margaret? More or less? All right, we'll give everyone a second to get ready. Everyone, hello, welcome. We're going to go ahead and get started. I'm just want to do, that's right. We'll do just a quick mic check. Margaret, is that sounding better now? So it sounds like it needs to go up a little bit more. Let's try that. Is that better now? Hello, hello, testing. Sounds like that's lower, isn't it? Hello, everyone. Can you hear me? Margaret, is that better now? Okay. Hello? Okay. Well, everyone, good afternoon. Welcome to our International Graduate and Professional Student Orientation. My name is Brandon Lanners, and I'm the Executive Director of the Office of Global Learning. It's a pleasure to welcome you all here to Cornell, maybe to Ithaca for your first time, maybe even to the United States for the first time. My office, the Office of Global Learning, is here to support all of you, all of our international students and our international scholars in issues with immigration, and also making sure that you feel welcome and included here on campus. You'll have a chance today to hear from a variety of speakers talking about different campus resources. We are also going to have excuse me, a panel at the end. As well as a surprise visit, cross your fingers. We're hoping the surprise visit will happen. It'll be worth it if it does. And we're also going to have a reception. So just a time for light refreshments and an opportunity just to get to meet some others who've also probably traveled a very long time to get here and might also be falling asleep during parts of this presentation. The Office of Global Learning, we don't judge jet lag, all right? So we're gonna go get started in just a moment. I do want to say that as part of our goal to make sure you feel welcome and included here on campus, you're gonna see a variety of communications come out from our office throughout the year. Some of those will be focused on immigration. Others will be focused on different kinds of events and programs that we offer to get to know other international students and to get resources to make sure that your time here is successful. Be on the lookout for those. We have a newsletter that we send out every month. The first issue is going to be coming out in the next couple of weeks. And, you know, we'll always send out other, especially urgent messages to all of you through your email. So we'll have more time to talk about some of those things coming up. But I would now like to introduce our next speaker. So Wendy Wolford is our Vice Provost for International Affairs. And in her spare time, she's also the Robert A. and Ruth E. Paulson Professor for Global Development. Wendy Wolford, thanks so much for being here.
Thanks, Brandon, and good afternoon, everyone. Before I get started, let me just say a huge thank you to Brandon, to Lauren, to Margaret, all of the people who have organized all of these orientation events for the graduate students and the undergraduates. I think they've had more ice cream than even they wanted. If you haven't had Cornell ice cream yet, you're overdue. You should have some. So a huge welcome to all of you. You probably don't know this yet, but graduate students are the lifeblood of this university. All of us are incredibly excited to see you here. And you are graduate students, professional students, graduate students in the most international class ever, I think, at Cornell. We don't, I guess, pull the numbers until the fall, but about 60% of our graduate students, graduate and professional students, are international. So you've joined a fantastic group, a community that is worldwide, both in their experience here on campus and afterwards in their work, research, and studying after Cornell. So welcome to Ithaca and to Cornell. Let me ask you for a show of hands for anybody who came from a town. Oh, no, that's all the way through. Oh, Lauren, this is not the right presentation. This is Gustavo's old presentation. If you have my presentation, throw it up. If you don't, it's all right. I'll just pretend that we have pictures. I have really good pictures. I'll send them to you afterwards. But let me just ask for a show of hands for anyone who is from a town that is smaller than Ithaca, who coming from a town or a place that is smaller than Ithaca. Okay, maybe one, two, three people. You might be thinking in coming here, what have I done? Where are all the people? Where's a decent store? Don't go to our mall. It's literally one of the most depressing places. But it is a town that people refer to as centrally isolated, which is a nice way of saying in the middle of nowhere. It takes about 4 hours to get anywhere. But in all honesty, it takes 4 hours to get to four or five fantastic cities. So Toronto, Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Buffalo. So there's a lot around us. You're centrally isolated. You're close to a whole bunch of things. But it can seem like Ithaca is somewhat remote or isolated. And I'm here as the Vice Provost of International Affairs just to stress how international and connected this community is, this university community. Don't worry about it. I mean, if it's easy to do, but don't stress about it. oh, sure, you want me to walk away? While we're working on the images. It's an incredibly international community. Not only are 24% of our students international, and that's 50 to 60% of all of our graduate students are international. About 13 to 15% of our staff and faculty are international. And almost every single one of our faculty are engaged in international research or international research collaborations. And I just gave a welcome at the new faculty orientation and asked them that question. I also asked them if any of them had come from a smaller town, and only one said yes. So it's pretty universal. So the university, now you're gonna see my presentation and be like, really? She was worried about that. Okay. It is an international place to be, and despite how small our airport is, it's very connected globally. So people have international relationships, and also we have a lot of international programming here on our campus. I'm gonna briefly go through some of the offerings that we have in this office, but I will say, just like Brandon said, Global Cornell has been created in order to support our international student, staff, and faculty here on our campus, and also to provide opportunities and support our students, staff, and faculty from across the whole university when they want to engage in international work or engage internationally in either teaching or research. So think about this unit, Global Cornell, as a unit that's here for you. Come and find us, ask us questions. We hope to see you at different points along your journey here. So we did the international graduation in April, and hope to see you then in anywhere from 2 to 12 years, given normative time. I'm gonna go briefly through some of these. As Brandon said, Brandon Lanners is the executive director of Global Learning, and that has international services in it and also education abroad. International service is your one-stop shop for international immigration questions or any questions you might have related to your status. Check with them early and often. I had an international graduate student who went to Berkeley should for a job, Berkeley should know their international stuff front and back. They have a number of international faculty. They forgot to check a box on her paperwork, and as a result, she couldn't teach for the first semester because they hadn't properly appointed her as a faculty member. So that's just to say it happens, people are human. Check your documents, check your status, ask questions early and often. Find Brandon, find the excellent team in international services. They're really there to provide that support. Global operations is another part of our team. This might be a unit you won't see much, but what I want to emphasize, they're here to support all of the work that the whole community does overseas. So hiring, goods and services, research experiences abroad. One thing that they do in particular is travel, health, and safety. We have an international travel registry. If you're traveling internationally for Cornell-related business, it's mandatory to register that travel so that we can provide insurance and international services support for you. We also have in the unit and at the university the Mario Einaudi Center for International and Area Studies. They're a fantastic organization. The Einaudi Center works with area programs, so all of the areas are represented, and also cross-area programs. They give out about $1 million of travel and research funding to graduate and undergraduate students, mostly graduate students, and help to support international and domestic students in their international field research and teaching. So the Mario Einaudi Center, they run weekly programs in each one of these area studies programs. We have about 16,000 people who come through the center for programming every year. Really wonderful work. We also have the Global Grand Challenges at the university, which is a university-wide initiative around a particular challenge that we think that Cornell can actually help to address. This first Global Grand Challenge that was chosen through a university-wide conversation is migrations, and we're holding our competition really for the second Global Grand Challenge in October of this year, so you'll hear more about this. But if any part of your work is related to migrations of humans, plants, or animals, or the context in which people move, please come to the webpage and see us. We've created a new initiative as of this past fall. In 2022, we launched the Cornell Global Hubs. These are strategic relationships in a number of places around the world where we have more infrastructure, we have a Cornell relationship across the university with our university partners in these places. If you're interested in being able to connect to those institutions or having a home base, if you're going to do research internationally, many of our partners are probably represented by alumni here in the audience. So if you're interested in having a continued connection between Cornell and a local institution, then these global hubs might be a place where you would find the capacity for that connection. Really briefly, I want to spend the rest of my presentation, which is not supposed to be too long. I'm already getting timestamps from the front. I want to spend the rest of the presentation talking about two different things, about free expression and then academic integrity. We do this for everybody. I was going to say you're not special. Of course you're special, but we're not doing this for you because you're international students. We do it for everyone, and this particular year is a year where we're going to spend a lot of time talking about free expression across the university, because the president, President Pollack, has chosen free expression as a theme for us to talk about as a university community. So first I'll start with our core values, just because free expression is one of those. The core values were part of a university-wide conversation, 5 years ago, 2017, 2018, discussions all across students, staff, faculty, all the different colleges. What were the values that really represented Cornell? What did we all feel we were working together to forward? A lot of pizza conversations. In the end, we chose these six and actually hold them quite dearly. None of them will maybe be a surprise. The first one, purposeful discovery, that's discovery with a particular land grant mission of being able to make a difference in the world. So one of the taglines for the university is land grant to the world. How can we take science, social science, physical science, life science, the humanities, how can we take our work and understand how that works in the world, understand what kind of an impact it could make in the world. So purposeful discovery is a pretty obvious first one. The second one is free and open inquiry and expression, and I'll get back to that one. The third one is a community of belonging, and you might think that sounds really cheesy, a community of belonging. It's really something that we hold pretty strongly, and I don't know if you've ever heard Cornell called the nice ivy. It is the nice ivy. I've been to the others. No, I'm sure they're nice too. But the community of belonging just means not only that we strive for diversity and inclusion, but that we also respect everybody at the community and empower them to have a voice. So it's about creating kindness and a spirit of collaboration, in addition to some inevitable competition, but having competition be for the sake of the broader community and learning. The fourth one is exploration across boundaries, and you all are really the living embodiment of that exploration across boundaries, because the way we do our graduate fields at the university is different than many places. It's not by discipline or even by department, but by graduate field. And when I came to Cornell in 2010, I was like, what? Why would we have somebody from a whole separate college get to decide graduate admissions for my department, right? And they can, because they're part of a graduate field, not part of a department or a discipline. And it's so refreshing, because instead of thinking about things based on what three or four usually deceased people thought, at least in the social sciences, that can be quite an unpromising way to start your investigation. You start thinking about the tools you need across disciplines to answer any given question. So if I want to think about migration, instead of just working within sociology, I can think about a particular migratory issue and think, do I need to understand this in the context of climate change? Do I need models from earth and atmospheric science in order to understand why these people are making the decision they're making? So it's really about thinking across borders, and I've never been in a place that's as collaborative as Cornell. There's actually funding and support for research that takes place across colleges, departments, disciplines. We've just created new fields, new departments. So we have a department now of design technology that crosses architecture and engineering. And that's just one, we have many. So find a way to make your graduate education almost exploratory. You come here because you're increasingly specialized. You have a very good idea of what it is you want to do. But one colleague described this place to me as a candy store. You get to try all these different things, and that's not how I ever experienced a candy store. But, you know, you get to put things together and make your curriculum do work for you, not you just working for your curriculum. So exploration across boundaries. The fifth one, again, is that land grant mission. And we've taken that land grant mission and made it part of the whole character of the university. So you'll hear a lot about engagement. You'll hear a lot about working with communities, whether those communities are United Nations missions or NGOs or conservationists. Engaging is a key part of what our students, staff, and faculty do. The sixth one, respect for the natural environment. That one maybe seems obvious because of where we live, right? This is a fantastic place to be, and it's a fantastic place to be outside. It's a really wonderful space. And so respecting that environment is key, but also, of course, in the context of everything going on, global climate change, environmental degradation, respecting and thinking about that, thinking about the work you do and the kind of engagement you have here on the university in the context of this broader picture is incredibly important. So, okay, just a minute more on free and open expression. People often confuse free and open expression with academic freedom, and they're different but related. Academic freedom means that you as graduate students and I as a faculty member, we can say what the parameters of expression are within a particular paper or academic conversation or a classroom, right? So I don't have to tolerate discussion on everything. There is no gravity in my class if I've established that that isn't part of the set of things we're going to discuss, right? So I have academic freedom in order to be able to establish the parameters of that conversation. Free expression is outside of that. People have the right to be able to express their thoughts, their opinions, their beliefs, and we have the right to express and then engage. We have the right to argue. We have the right to protest, right? What we also have the right to do is to be able to engage in dialogue with the hopes that we might change those opinions, right? This is a learning environment. But what we don't have a lot of space for is disruption. So it isn't, free expression means that people do have the right to express their opinion, even if it's something you find awful or odious, and to continue to express that without being disrupted. So again, that's different than academic freedom, and it is just a commitment in this university space to have people be able to express their ideas and opinions. We are gonna be talking about that a lot this year. So President Pollack, like I said, has made this a key theme, and we will have presentations, there will be an opera, on it. There will be artistic exhibitions about free expression, and I invite you to engage in it. It might be outside your studies, but this is an important topic in the university here in the United States, here in Ithaca, but also around the world. What is our purpose, and how do we think about ideas? How do we treat them, right? Okay. Then academic integrity. Academic integrity is in some ways becoming more fraught. It always has been, but two things I think make it even more fraught now than before. One of those is ChatGPT and other similar tools that provide incredible opportunity. There's incredible learning that can be done using these natural language processing tools, and also challenges to navigate. So that's one thing. The technology has changed in ways that are going to really make us talk early and often about academic integrity. The other piece is what started with a more focused replication movement, particularly in the medical and biological sciences, and that now has spread to behavioral sciences, behavioral economics. There's a significant push to examine the results of the research that we all do and look at the publications that come out of that. And as you know, there have been high level instances of people having to step down from their positions, retracting papers, and some of our most exciting science, what is it in Nature? Like 25% of all of their articles now are being retracted because they publish things like this, right, in order to get cutting edge science out. But then upon future reflection, it looks like maybe some of those were gained in error or they were too hasty. These two things, the technology and also the real focus on this, mean that as graduate students, it's important to understand what the landscape is and to talk to your colleagues, your partners, your peers, and your faculty advisors and professors as early and often as possible. What's feasible? What's appropriate in any given situation? What does authorship look like? In most cases, ChatGPT is okay to use, right? It's a tool, and some people are likening it to a calculator. I actually think that's a pretty dangerous analogy, but I'm a social scientist, what do I know? That was a joke. I know a lot as a social scientist. And I think, you know, in terms of technology gone rogue, we might want to dial up some of our social science friends. The university is right now discussing an official policy around these tools, right? OpenAI, ChatGPT. It hasn't been issued yet, but basically the thrust of it will be that it depends, right? How and in what ways you can use them will depend on a particular class, what the professor has said in that class. But underlying any use of ChatGPT, OpenAI, will be the need to attribute, right? So saying this was produced with the assistance of ChatGPT, never presenting ChatGPT's words as your own, those sort of hard lines are going to be part of any policy or any communication we put out. So right now what we're saying is talk to your professors in class, talk to your colleagues, find out what the guidelines are for the use of that technology in any given class or in any given publication or relationship. So that's one. In terms of the replication issues and how we do our research, that's always been an issue for us, right? We have to manage our time, make sure you take enough time that you know whether the notes that you took one day were verbatim or already processed so that you can draw from those words for your publication. It's so easy to make a mistake. It's so easy to do something you didn't intend, but a really, you know, hard thing to undo once it's been published, let's say, right? Once you've inadvertently taken words perhaps from some other source, it can be very difficult to undo. There's also a real question with graduate and professional students, of co-authorship. That's not really academic integrity, but it's one of those questions of, you know, that you'll be confronting constantly, maybe now as graduate students and then afterwards as faculty or mentors yourself. Who gets to be an author? How much constitutes a right to authorship? And what order will the authors be? And that is going to differ for every faculty member. It's going to differ for every publication. The order will differ in some fields. As you know, the first author is the one who contributed the most or who really sponsored the ideas. And in some fields, the last author is that person, right? So early and often consult with your teams. If it's a collaborative project, consult with your faculty if you're working with them on a project. Find out what the norms and the rules are for co-publication. And I want to say to all of you that you're already signing up for several years, again, from 2 to 12 years, of difficult work, right? Being a graduate student is a lot of work. It is a lot of pressure. There's not always a really clear set of things you have to do. You're scrambling to figure out yourself. What are the norms about how much I should be reading, how much I should be publishing, what kind of research question I should be taking on? It's a lot. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of stress. And you're trying to figure all of these things out. But you have this community of peers. You have each other. You have your faculty. You have their labs. But I know that as international graduate students, there's an extra anxiety. Just thinking about what's possible given status in the US, given sort of where your parents are, your family, maybe they're really close, maybe they're in just over the border in Montreal. I was an international student in Montreal, and I enjoyed it very much, although everybody made fun of me really all the time as an American. So I hope that doesn't happen. But I know there's extra anxiety, so feel free to reach out to us as international advocates in my office and in Brandon's, and also talk to your faculty advisors. There's a whole apparatus here on campus to support you and take advantage of it. And also make time to get out. Go explore. See what you find in the local area. There's a lake It's big, it's 50 miles long. Boat on it or swim in it. My fifth grade class, my son was in fifth grade. They always go to New York City. A couple years ago, they decided to go out on the lake because more people had been to New York City than to the lake that's about a mile away from here. So explore the area and explore academically. And good luck. Thanks.
Okay, everyone, we're gonna wait for just a moment. We're just doing a quick switch of presentation. We'll get going again. And maybe while we're waiting, Wendy, I think you had asked about size of town, right, that people are coming from. So I've done this before, and it's always exciting to see. Some of you might have just driven across the border to get here, just, right? That's anxiety producing enough. Others of you have probably flown here, some from further away than for others. What I want to see is who holds the record in this room for the longest trip to get here. So when you left, wherever it was that you left from, and getting to, let's just say, Ithaca. All right? So I'm going to start with a lower time, and I'm going to keep moving up. And I want everyone to raise their hands right now. Everybody raise your hands. Raise them up, come on, come on, come on. And then as I move up, if your trip to get here was less than that, you lower your hand, right? So if I say 5 hours and it only took 3 hours to get here, you'll put your hand down. Okay, so starting up, ready? 3 hours, 5 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours, half a day, 15 hours, 20 hours, all right, 24 hours, that's impossible. Who's lying here? All right, 30 hours. So if your hand is up because it took you more than 30 hours to get here, okay, 35 hours. I recognize that this is cruel because you've been sitting for 35 hours and now you're sitting there with your hand up. So 35 hours, 40 hours, 45 hours, 50 hours, and I'm so sorry. All right, let's see, we have, okay, 55 hours. There's one, two, all right, hold them up high so I can see. Okay, just want to scan really quickly. Okay, first in the front with the white hat. You drove here from California, San Diego. How many hours? 12 days. All right. United States is not that big. You must have gotten lost somewhere, but you found us. So happy. So, so 12 days, and then I think you had your hand up as well. Wow, so we flew from Vietnam to Madison, Wisconsin, ate some cheese. I live close by to Wisconsin. They have really good cheese in Wisconsin. You stayed there eating cheese, and then you got here 4 days later. Well, thank you all so much. A round of applause for everyone that went through so much to get here. Thank you. And so now that we have our presentation switched up, thank you all for participating. I'd like to introduce Officer Jody Conzella, who's going to be talking with us about the Cornell University Police Department, your safety and your security on campus. Thank you so much for being here, Officer Conzella.
Excellent. Thank you so much, everyone, for being here, for having us. We got to make sure this advances. Hold on. Where do I point it?
Okay, thanks.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. All right, so we at Cornell University, please feel so fortunate to serve such a diverse community. So the next 25 minutes, you'll learn a little bit about our department and where we're located and what we offer you as far as resources here at Cornell University while you're here. So here's a little bit of a visual of just kind of how a flowchart of how things work here at the university. The police department is under the Division of Public Safety. So these are some of the needs that we meet for the community. Medical, fire, law enforcement, obviously is us. And then our Public Safety Communication Center, which we'll talk about. That is who answers the phone when you call 607-255-1111. All right, so a little bit about our department. We are a fully staffed police agency, and we do operate 24/7, 365. So we never take a day off. We are always there for you if you need help of any kind, whether it's emergency or non-emergency help. And we are located right across the street in Barton Hall. So some of you will see a picture and it might look familiar. Our building is quite large and stately. We have approximately 50 sworn officers currently, a major investigations unit. So they investigate frauds, scams, any kind of really large crimes that happen here on campus. And then two canines, and also their handlers. And we'll see pictures of them as well, because everybody loves a picture of a dog or two. And then the community engagement team. So that is, that's the team that I'm a part of. And it's this is what we do. We engage with community and we complete programming and tabling sessions. So we kind of really are the face of the department. We don't really take calls per se, but we engage with the community on multiple levels. Like I said, we're located in Barton Hall, which is across the street, and we are an accredited agency. So it's something that we are really proud of. Basically, what it means to be an accredited agency is just that we have policies and procedures that are audited regularly by an international organization. All right, so there's a picture of Barton Hall. Like I said, most of you will probably go to Barton Hall for the indoor track, which is upstairs, or for Lost and Found, which is downstairs. So if you do lose anything and you want to check and see if Lost and Found has your items, that's where it's located. So again, just east of this building. So that's also where our Division of Public Safety is located. So these are our telecommunicators. Basically, when you call for help, these are the individuals that pick up the phone. So again, being a 24/7 agency, there is someone always, at least two telecommunicators in Barton Hall. So it is considered a safe space 24 hours a day. If you need to go somewhere and guarantee that you can get help, that is where you can go any hour of the day. They also, so aside from answering the phone, the emergency and non-emergency calls, they also take all of the fire alarms and burglar alarms on campus. It's a very high-tech space. There's lots of screens and techie things. They also answer all of the Rave Mobile Guardian calls and security timers. So we'll talk a little bit more about that app and how you can utilize it to help keep you safe here on campus, and as well as the Cornell Lost and Found, like I said. And again, it's kind of blocked here by the prompter at the bottom, but our phone number is 607-255-1111. So you're going to want to make sure that you have that in your phone. That is our emergency and non-emergency number. Does anybody need it again? Okay. Again, one more time. All right. 607-255-1111. Doesn't have to just be called in an emergency. You can still utilize 911, but you will be transferred back to Cornell Police Dispatch because they're the only ones that dispatch Cornell Police, okay? If you live off campus, you can still, again, call 911. We might not be the agency that responds if you live outside of our jurisdiction, okay? All right, so this is our police chief, and since he can't be here, we're gonna read off, if he could be here, he would say that his vision is to continue our progress in partnership with the community. We must understand each other and take into consideration everybody's safety first while making sure we are treating people with empathy. So when I say that our police agency is we take pride in being very specialized police agency, and that is reflected in our hiring process and also in our training as well. So when I say that we consider ourselves to be different than other police agencies, I really mean that. Okay, so a little bit more about that, just to give you an idea of what our officers, how they're trained. They go through a 6 to 8 month police academy, and that is certified through New York State. And then once they are done with their 6 to 8 months of training at an independent police training department, they come back here, and then they have a few more weeks of training in which they specifically learn the geography here at Cornell University, which you will learn eventually is vast. There are hundreds of buildings, and our officers know each and every single one of them and how to get there in the most expedient manner. Paperwork, which again, like I said, policies and procedures we have a lot of, and vehicle and traffic. So if you plan on driving on campus, you might want to brush up on your traffic law, right? So bicycles and vehicles have to abide by New York State traffic laws. So you can get a ticket if you are breaking any of those laws, because again, our number one priority here is safety, okay? The safety of the community. So, and then specialty assignments and an observation phase. So if you're adding all of that time up, it takes almost a year to have a fully trained Cornell police officer here. And again, our officers in that training, that field training phase, are trained to engage and understand Cornell's diverse community. All right, so this is a little bit of an overview of our responsibilities. Essentially, we assist the community with criminal and non-criminal complaints, right? So anything from checking on the welfare of a beaver at a dam. I've been on that call firsthand. The beaver was okay. He was just doing his normal thing. To any kind of criminal complaints, right? So our number one reported crime here on campus is larceny, okay? So larceny is theft. Right. So if you're going to have a bicycle on campus, you want to make sure that you are purchasing a really high quality bike lock, because we do take those reports frequently that bicycles, laptops, items can be taken if they are not secured properly. So I would recommend that you register your bicycle with Cornell Transportation. And also write down and take pictures of serial numbers. So if you have laptops, high value items, you're gonna wanna make sure that you have that information in the event that you have to provide it in a police report. We also enforce the laws, like I said, so not just the penal law of New York State, but also vehicle and traffic law, local laws, so things like open containers, public urination, that sounds so embarrassing, but it happens, especially after a night on the town. And also the local community standards, right? So the Student Conduct and Community Standards Office, right? And then also respond to emergencies. So if you ever hear sirens going off across the community, typically that would be ourselves, possibly emergency medical services or environmental health and safety, responding to something like a medical emergency or maybe even a fire alarm, okay? All right, so if you see us on campus, we do have multiple ways that we patrol. So typically by vehicle. And if you get to walk across the street, you'll see our parking lot. So you'll get a glimpse of what our patrol vehicles look like. So you'll know what they look like by bicycle and then also by on foot. So our officers are approachable and they really, like I said, engage with the community. So please, if you see one of them out, feel free to introduce yourself and to ask any questions that you have. All right, so as promised, these are pictures of our two canines. So the one on the left, the German Shorthair Pointer, is Luna, and the one on the right is Axel. So you might see them on campus. They are not drug dogs. They are trained in explosive detection and also tracking. So sometimes you'll see them if we have a dignitary on campus, they'll be doing sweeps, and also they do demonstrations as well. Their training is quite impressive. Okay, so multiple ways that you can make contact with Cornell University Police. Like I said before, you can still call 911 from your cell phone. It will get you help in any situation, especially if you're off campus. If you are on campus, 607-255-1111 is the optimal number to call. Our emergency response time on campus is 2 to 3 minutes for a priority one call, okay? A priority one call is not that you've been locked out of your room, okay? That is a crime in progress, okay? So just be aware that that doesn't count in certain situations. A blue light or emergency phone. So as you can see in the picture, that is a photo of a blue light phone. And the emergency phone does the same thing, but they're located interior buildings. So they look like a yellow call box, and they're usually located near exits and stairwells. So that will get you direct line to Cornell Public Safety. And basically when you push the button, you will hear a telecommunicator say, "Cornell Public Safety, what's your emergency?" And then you can have a conversation freely. Some benefits to using a blue light phone or an emergency phone is that they know your exact location. So if you're on campus and you're still learning the campus, you're not sure where you are, it might be beneficial to utilize one of these methods rather than your cell phone, because unless you have the Rave Guardian app, we will not be able to tell your location immediately, okay? The Rave Guardian app, which we will talk about in a few slides, has multiple ways that you can connect with us, and also the silent witness form. So the silent witness form is important for us to know that the community is aware of, because it is an anonymous reporting tool, okay? So if you are, maybe there's a fear of retaliation and you have some important information that you want to relay to our department, that is one way that you could do that. The silent witness form is located on AVP Honan's public safety message that you will get in your emails. It's also located on our website, okay? So you can always find a link to that there. And then again, our website and email. All right, so a little bit about the Rave Guardian app. Number one thing to know, it's free. I don't know why that's at the bottom, it should be at the top. So we know that you spend a lot of money here at Cornell, but this is one thing that they pay for you to have. So this app is really, really amazing when it comes to safety and security. It allows you to text with Cornell Police. You can send pictures, you can be anonymous. And it again, if you have to be quiet in a situation, so maybe you're in a situation where you have to run, hide, fight, and you're hiding, you can text with Cornell Police and get important information still while remaining quiet, okay? There's a 911 panic alarm button. So depending on whether you have an Apple or an Android, it's a 2 to 3 button push to get help. Safety tips. So there are phone numbers to multiple different resources across campus that you can utilize right at your fingertips as well as university resources. So that will take you to their websites. And also there is a safety timer. So the safety timer kind of acts like a virtual escort on campus. You can set multiple guardians. And when you are walking and set your safety timer, your guardian will be alerted that your timer is set and they will be able to see where you are walking on campus. And if you have an emergency, you can alert them, or if your timer goes off, they can reach Cornell Police and let us know that you are in duress and we need to check on you. All right, so there is a QR code for the Rave Guardian if anybody wants to snap a quick picture of it. We will also be available at a table this afternoon. So that will probably be there if you don't have a chance. I see some phones up, so I'm gonna wait. Okay, moving on. Okay, a little bit more about the silent witness form. Like I said before, it is available through the public safety newsletter that goes out weekly. Please read those newsletters. They have important information of things that we're seeing on campus, trends, maybe frauds or scams, which happen frequently, unfortunately, and target our international population. So I urge you, if you have any questions about the scams or the fraud that happens on campus, come and see us. If you have someone call you on the phone claiming to be from a department, a government agency, you can physically come to our police agency and verify if that is or is not a situation. Remembering we're open 24/7, okay? And there is a link to our website. Okay, so here's a picture of some of our officers. So this is pretty much what our officers wear on campus. Some of them are wearing bike uniforms. So you know what they look like when you see them out and about. But in 2022, our police agency handled over 38,000 calls on campus. So most of those were not priority one calls, okay? So not crimes in progress. And then here are some of the programs that we offer here. Like I said before, we are really fortunate to have a community engagement team here. And it allows us to meet the community's needs when it comes to programming, right? So we do offer this list of programs. Response to active threat is our number one requested program. Unfortunately, considering the climate of internationally, this is information that people feel like is very helpful, right? And then recognizing workplace violence and alcohol awareness programs. I mentioned canine demonstrations. Another one that is very helpful, especially to international grad students, maybe even to your spouses or family members, if you have them here, is the winter driving program. So that if you've never operated a motor vehicle in the winter here, it can be daunting. And there are some special tips that you might want to know. So that is a program that might be helpful. So here is, again, shameless plug, QR codes to our Facebook and Instagram if you want to follow us and see what we're doing and also communicate with us on that level. And it's hard to see, but there it is. It's hard to see because it's not there. Here is our contact information. So this is Sergeant Haynes is one of our canine handlers, and he is the sergeant in charge of community engagement and recruiting. And my partner, Beverly, and then my information. So our email address is cupd_engagement@cornell.edu in the event that you're interested in any of our programming or you have any questions. I cannot overstate enough that we do have an open door policy. So, and I mean that literally and figuratively. So we welcome all kinds of questions, whether it's through email, in person, or over the phone, okay? And that is my direct phone number there, so 255-7404. No question is too small. We understand that you are coming from regions around the world that have very different relationships with their police agencies, and the laws are very different. So please don't hesitate to ask questions if there's something that you are unsure of. Do we have time for questions? I told you I was going to be in, I wouldn't go over time. 4 minutes? Okay. Is it possible to take questions? Anybody?
Yes.
Okay, good question. So the question was, for those in the back, if you are calling for a medical emergency, would you call 911 or 607-255-1111? And the answer to that is, if you are on campus, then you would call 607-255-1111. So we will be dispatched, our officers, as well as Cornell EMS, and also the local ambulance service. So here locally, it's called Bangs, but they also will be dispatched to evaluate that patient. So answer your question? Okay, good. Any other questions? Yes, in the front. The safety timer on the app? Yeah, so like I said, when you download the app, give yourself a good 10 to 15 minutes to set up that app. You are going to need to set your guardians. So your guardians are going to be people that are alerted when you set your timer. You can set a roommate. You could set a friend or family back home. You could set Cornell Police. Okay. If you decide to set Cornell Police as your guardian, the only difference is our telecommunicators will be notified that you set a timer. They can't see where you are on campus until your timer expires, okay? Just know that our policy at Cornell Police is that if your timer expires and we need to check with you and make sure you're okay, we have to do that physically, okay? We can't just do it over the phone because you could be under duress, okay? So we will send an officer to your location. Yeah, 2 minutes. Maybe one or two more questions? Yes, right here. How do you know if you're in another, well, if you go online, we have our campus watch and we basically have a map of Cornell University and what property is ours. So obviously Central Campus, where we are right now, is gonna be Cornell University property. Anything that's adjacent to Cornell owned property, and our property is really vast, right? So we own property in College Town, Cascadilla, Sheldon Court. So we can respond to anything that's adjacent to Cornell owned property. Okay. Really, we work closely with all of our local agencies. So Ithaca Police, Tompkins County, New York State Police, the community, the services, the emergency services in this entire county is really very professional and very similar. Okay. Make sense? Cool. Okay, so I think that's all the time I have. Thank you very much. It is nice to meet you, and I hope you all have a wonderful semester.
Well, thank you very much, Officer Gonzalez. I really appreciate that time. One thing I would like to say, and just to emphasize for everyone, is the piece about the scams. Okay, so this is something that, you know, the Cornell Police, my office, and others on campus have to work with much more frequently than we would like. All students, you know, no matter their background, are fall for scams, right? So they're victims of scams. My office hears about students that are international students that are victims of scams. And it is absolutely heartbreaking. especially knowing that many times when students are victims of scams, they maybe don't feel that they have someone to turn to ask for help. And so they just, you know, start responding and they work with the person that's maybe sent them an email or that has called them. Please, please, if you get an email or if you receive a phone call that does not sound right, maybe that's to offer an internship opportunity or a job opportunity, or someone's calling from the US government saying that you owe taxes or something is wrong with your immigration, please call the Cornell police. Please call my office. Send us an email. We can work with you to determine the validity of that message. So again, if you have any doubt, or even if you don't have a doubt, please just reach out to us so that, that we can help you. So now for our next speaker, I would like to introduce, looks like you can't see his name, but we have our prompter up there, my colleague, Nicholas Mahan, our immigration specialist in the Office of Global Learning, will be talking with us now about international services and some important information on immigration. So thank you so much, Nick.
Okay, hello everybody. Thanks for the round of applause. It's always great to get. So we're gonna be talking about not all F1 and J1 international student regulations. That would probably take the first days. But we're just gonna go over the most important F1 and J1 immigration regulations for students that have just arrived to the US or perhaps just transferred to Cornell. So again, my name is Nicholas Mahan. I'm an immigration specialist with International Services, which is part of the Office of Global Learning. So we're gonna go over four topics today: who we are and what we do, that being international services, how to maintain your status, employment, and travel. Okay, so in most cases, we are your first stop. If you have immigration questions, if you are having maybe some problems navigating the US immigration system. So in that way, we advise F1 and J1 students and related authorization. We will also advise on how to maintain your immigration status, how to get a social security number. Perhaps you want to bring a spouse or a child. So we'll help you navigating the processes for bringing them here on F2 or J2 status. And of course, much more. Okay, so some very important stuff on maintaining your student status. So if you're a new student, you're all new students, but even if you're a transfer student, everybody has to complete our online status activation. I imagine most of you may have already completed it because we've been getting a lot of activations that we've been processing, but there may be a number of you that haven't completed it yet. It's very important that you complete that, because if you don't complete it, we cannot activate your CVIS record, your immigration record. And if we don't do that, you'll fall out of status, which is not a good thing, as you all know. So furthermore, on how to maintain your student status, you have to stay enrolled as a full-time student. If for some reason you feel you can't enroll as a full-time student, you need to come and talk to us if you think that's a possibility. Don't work off campus without authorization. All off campus work requires either authorization from our office or the Department of Homeland Security. Okay. So remember, you cannot accept off campus employment unless you come talk to us first and you've received authorization. Working off campus without authorization could lead to your CVIS record, your immigration record being terminated. So very important to remember. Follow policies and laws. So that's all Cornell policies, all state laws, everything. All that is tied in with your immigration status. Okay, so you have to comply with Cornell's academic conduct policies. And as I said, all US federal and state laws. Violating those laws, those academic conduct policies, could also lead to a status termination, which you definitely do not want. Next, notify us if you change your address. Your residence address is contained within your CVS record. So if you move, we need to update that address in your CVS record. And it's very easy to do. You just do that via your My Status portal. Most of you should have already received emails now to access your My Status portal, because that's also the same place you go to require to complete your required status activation. Okay, so it's important that you let us know within 10 days of your move, because that's what the federal regulations require, is notification within 10 days. And again, just to let you know, new students need to complete that online required status activation, and you need to do that before you submit an address update in your My Status portal. Okay. So some further guidelines for maintaining your status is to keep your passport valid. Okay, all of you should have entered the U.S. with a valid passport, or else it wouldn't come in so easily. But when it's when your passport is close to expiring, okay, you need to contact your embassy or the closest consulate for your country to renew your passport, okay? And you'll want to begin the process well before the expiration date. Some consulates and some embassies can take several months to renew a passport, so you don't want to contact them the day before your passport expires, okay? They won't be able to renew it that quick. If you feel you need more time for your academic program and you need to extend your F1 status, that's something you need to apply early for, okay? Several weeks before, okay? So you can apply for an extension if you have a compelling academic reason. Maybe if you're all graduate students, maybe your research is taking longer than you thought it would. Your thesis or dissertation is taking longer, reasons like that. Or medical reasons, if you had to maybe take a semester or two off because you needed to receive medical treatment in the United States, reasons like that. But again, start that process early. Do not wait the day before your status is set to expire, okay? And that you'll contact us, of course, to extend your F1 extension, or to process your F1 or J1 extension. Notify us if you plan to transfer. So if you're transferring to another school, that is also has an immigration process behind it, because we will need to transfer your CVS record, your immigration record, to that new school. And again, that process can also be done in your My Status portal. You'll find that almost every immigration process that you will do with our office can be done through your My Status portal. Okay. Okay. So, when you graduate and you are on F1 OPT, or if you're lucky enough to be eligible for a STEM extension and you get additional 2 years of work authorization, you still have to keep up with these reporting requirements, especially for your residence address, but also your employment. So basically, even when you've graduated from Cornell and you've gone on to start your careers and you're on OPT and STEM OPT, you still need to report to our office your residence address and at that point your employment. And yeah, you can just contact our office with any immigration questions you have. The address is, web address is right there. Okay, so employment, a big one. For on-campus, when you're registered, on-campus work is done for Cornell and paid by the university. So if you've been offered a job at, say, a dining hall, or if you've been offered an assistantship working in a Cornell lab, that is considered on-campus employment. While classes are in session, you can work a maximum of 20 hours per week, okay? If you are registered for the summer session, you are also restricted to 20 hours a week during the summer session as well, okay? So just remember that, 20 hours per week maximum for on-campus work while classes are in session and you're registered. If you're an F1 student, you don't need to apply for on-campus work authorization. It's kind of an automatic benefit of your status. If you're a J1 student, however, you do need to work with our office to receive on-campus employment authorization. It's a really simple process. You just fill out a really quick form. in your My Status portal, and then we can process it for you. Off campus, again, like I said before, any off campus employment requires authorization from either our office or the Department of Homeland Security. Okay. For F1 students, there's two types of practical training that would allow someone to work off campus. The first one is curricular practical training, CPT, which is usually used for students that maybe have to do internships as part of their degree program or a course they're enrolled in. Or if you're a PhD student, if you have an internship that's required for your thesis or dissertation research, or if you're a master's student as well. OPT is mainly used by students for after they graduate. That would allow you to seek employment in a field that's related to your major. Most students, 99.9999%, save OPT for after they graduate. They don't use their OPT while they're still in their academic program, okay? J1 students, however, don't have CPT or OPT. They have one type of off-campus work authorization, and that's called academic training, okay? But like OPT and CPT, if you're a J1 in academic training, the work, the internship, the training must be directly related to your major, okay? And there's more information on our website. So the link there. Okay, employment and F status. What I went over before. CPT is possible after 2 semesters of full-time enrollment with an active SEVIS record. Again, CPT is used for internships in between registered semesters. It's like the summer session. Okay, is the most used application. May only be used before graduation and must be part of an academic curricular requirement. So CPT is only before you graduate while you're still a student, and there has to be that academic requirement behind it. You apply through our office, through Global Learning International Services. You don't have to apply with the Department of Homeland Security, and it can either be granted as full or part-time. And again, there's a link there. Screenshot, and then you can see further the CPT requirements. Okay, OPT is a bit different from CPT, but one way they're similar is that to be eligible for OPT, you have to have been a full-time, fully enrolled student for 2 semesters, okay, with an active SEVIS record. And again, like I said before, this is most often used after graduation. And you can receive for your initial OPT 12 months of employment authorization. If you graduate in a STEM field, you would be eligible to apply for an additional 24 months of employment authorization. Okay. And we will assist you with the OPT application process partly by providing you with a new I-20. That says you're eligible to apply for OPT and that we recommend you for OPT, but that application you will need to submit to the Department of Homeland Security, to USCIS more specifically. And it's just an online process that's really not too complicated. They've simplified it pretty well. Okay, travel. F1 students, we're gonna go over the documents we recommend you have on you. If you decide to travel internationally, while you're an F1 student in the US. Number one, very important, a valid passport. It has to be unexpired and in good condition. Of a valid entry stamp. So most of you came here using an F1 or J1 visa. If you're a Canadian, however, you do not have an F1 or J1 visa. So you do not have to present a visa stamp at the border or the port of entry, okay? You also must have an I-20 showing your F1 status signed for travel by one of the Office of Global Learning advisors, like me, within the last 12 months. However, if you are a Canadian, you will need to have that travel signature updated every 6 months. It's a little bit different for Canadian students. We'd recommend that you have your proof of financial support on you in case it's required or requested, I should say, by the CBP officer at the port of entry. So this would be the documents that mentioned the funding that's listed on your I-20. So bank statements from you or your sponsor, et cetera. We'd also recommend that you carry your proof of Cornell enrollment, and that can just be your transcript, something pretty easy. Okay. And you can find more information on these required and recommended documents, along with other travel tips, on our website, link right there. Okay, and then lastly, here's our contact information. We are in 300 Caldwell Hall on the Ag Quad. Our office hours are Monday to Friday, 8:30 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. You can find our phone number right there. If you have any general questions, any immigration questions, we ask that you email international@cornell.edu, and that will go to one of the immigration advisors or specialists in our office to answer. Our general webpage there is on the bottom. That's where you can find a lot of great information. If you have a question, we ask that you go to the website first, because we have so much information on there. Odds are your question can be answered on the website, but if it can't, that's what the email address is for, and that's what the phone number is for that you can contact. Lastly, you'll see a link to make an appointment. We don't really do walk-in advising appointments for non-emergency needs, but you can book an appointment either via Zoom or in person on our website, and we can provide assistance there. And I think that's about it. Should I take questions?
Great. Well, Nick, thank you very much. Really appreciate it. We're going to go move to our next presentation. So I would like to present our colleagues from the Dean of Students Office, Huey Hsiao and Kim Garrison. Welcome.
Noon, how are you? All right, there's some folks. Okay, good afternoon. Let's try it one more time. Good afternoon, how are you? Yes, woohoo. We are pumped. Got it?
Got it.
All right.
Hey, it's working. Good afternoon, everyone. I serve as Associate Dean of Students and Director of the Asian and Asian American Center within the Office of the Dean of Students. I'm here with...
My name is Kim Garrison. I use the pronouns she, her, and hers. I also work in the Dean of Students Office in Student Support and Advocacy Services, and we're pumped to be here today.
Next slide. Okay. To kick things off, just have a couple questions for you all. So who here has lived or studied in the US before, maybe as an undergrad or maybe high school or whenever? If you have, if you can stand, if you're able. It's a couple, you can be brave and stand. Okay, so stay standing. Actually, no, sit down. Who here is studying in the US? So is everyone else studying in the US for the first time? Yes, I assume. Okay. So those brave folks that stood up just now, those are potential resources. Those are people that have kind of had the experience of living in the US, and they could be great people to get to know, to give advice to you. How many of you speak more than two languages? Okay, I would say It seems like the majority of people here speak two languages. I know I can definitely speak one, English. My Spanish is passable, and my Chinese is decent, okay. But I would say the average US citizen can't speak more than two languages. So look at it as a strength to be able to speak more than two languages. You are very lucky. That is your superpower, so to speak.
One of the things we like to say is Ithaca, New York is beautiful all the time. It never snows. No? Okay, good. I'm glad this crowd is awake. Okay, that sounds great. It is beautiful all the time. I like to think it's beautiful all the time. We have amazing falls. We have beautiful summer. You're seeing the tail end of summer, right? Winter is great, and we'll chat more about that in a second. And spring is really, really nice as it starts to warm up here in Ithaca. We would love to know how many of you have ever experienced snow before. Feel free to raise your hand if you're able. All right, so it won't be a surprise to us when it snows in 6 months or 3 months, but in a little bit. So we just want to remind you of some of the signs that you'll see around campus when it does snow, a reminder to bundle up because it does get cold, winter jackets, snow boots, those kind of things. Some of the signs that you'll see around campus, just a reminder that like sidewalks might be have signs that say this sidewalk is closed, no winter maintenance, because they try to concentrate their energy onto a few of the sidewalks rather than all of them. So if you see that sign around campus when it does come wintertime and it starts to snow, kind of our guidance is to maneuver and use a different sidewalk if you're able to. So and have some fun in the snow too.
All right, so this is a look at a roadmap, a table of contents, just what we're gonna cover in today's short session. We're gonna speak a little bit about culture shock, how that's gonna affect your experience here, add to your stress a little bit. We'll give you the context of the division in which Kim and I are a part of, the Division of Student and Campus Life. We'll talk a little bit about what we do, especially in terms of finding, helping you all as students find belonging on campus. We're also gonna give you a little bit of context in terms of things that are happening like in the air, in society, in the US, in terms of gender inclusivity, Black Lives Matter, anti-Asian racism. And then finally, we're gonna kind of bring it together and speak about mental wellness, and this idea of getting connected. Getting connected, I think, will be a common stream throughout our presentation today. So some of you, especially those of you that studied abroad before, might have seen a graph like this showing culture shock. This is a pretty common graph that I've seen it before I went to study abroad, this feeling of, when you first go abroad, those first couple weeks, you're like, yay, everything is happy. This is so amazing. I love it here. Then all of a sudden, you might feel that, oh, geez, things are actually kind of different. This is making me kind of nervous and anxious. And then months later, one might come to acceptance. Okay, so I'm accepting what is different around me and things are being more normalized. Then finally this, and finally that level of that plateau to acceptance. I will say that this is not something that, this isn't a standard experience. It might depend on your personality, how you approach the world, your previous experiences abroad, whether it's in the US or other places outside of your home country. So there are a lot of other factors. But the thing that we want you to take away here is that whatever your culture shock is, it's gonna add to your stress here at Cornell on top of everything else that you're dealing with academically. And Kim will talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah, one of the other pieces that we like to talk about is the like, yes, it's going great, to the like, oh no, sometimes it's not going as well. And how do we find that balance right in the middle? This graph talks about it in terms of blue all the way over to red. And hopefully we're in that place up there with yellow, that we're really in this good stress peak. We know potentially when our deadlines are coming up, when our assignments are due, maybe when we need to get things into the Office of Global Learning, all of those moving pieces. And hopefully that's the place when we start to get to that exhaustion exhausted place where we go, oh no, I need some support. I need to ask for some help. And one of the things that we're talking about here is being connected, whether that's to our office, whether that's to the Office of Global Learning, whether that's to another office on campus, to really think about how do I get that support? We want you to ask for help. Help, asking for help can be hard, but it's really something that we're about here in multiple different ways. We want to get that support in place before we get to a place of really having some of that panic or breakdown or any of those other words that we might use with that. So the other thing that we talk about is what we're about kind of overall, thinking about our student and campus life. There's a number of different departments within student and campus life. We want our students to belong. We want you to know that you're a part of our Cornell community. We actually provide a definition of this as well as terms in terms of how we do this. We're really focused on your well-being. You've probably heard us say well-being or how we're taking care of ourselves 5 times in the last 7 minutes, right? And you'll probably hear it another 10 times. So thinking about that, how we grow through this experience, and for each one of us, that looks different, right? And then the last piece is collaboration. And sometimes that's on a staff lens, right? Sometimes that's with faculty, and sometimes that's amongst you as students, right? So Huey talked about folks that maybe have studied in the US before and how folks can be a resource. So that could also be some of the collaboration. This is what we're about kind of across the board. We wanted to make sure that we talked about it through the lens of the way we do our work.
So to elaborate more on this idea of belonging and to make you think about it in an actionable way, we want to give you some examples of what you can do. So for instance, there are over 1,000 student orgs on campus. It's probably too much to even think about, in my opinion. But I would say get involved with something, whether it's within your graduate program or something that serves the whole entire campus, undergrads and grad students. Definitely find something to get involved with in terms of student organizations, student leadership. Some of you might be doing assistantships. In a way, I think that's a way of student leadership, but you might be considering being a graduate resident fellow. There are a lot of opportunities for leadership on campus if you can make time for it. Volunteering is also something that you can do on campus or in the community. One place to look is the Einhorn Center for Community Engagement. So that's something, but there are many more. If you like sports, I'm assuming as a grad student, you're not playing a Division I sport, but you might want to play a sport for fun. And so there are intramurals, like, I don't know, soccer or basketball or something that you can play for fun with your friends as a way to relieve stress and meet new people. Student employment, I already talked a little bit about assistantships. There are other ways to get involved working on campus and much more. So we're going to transition a little bit here and talk a little about what I alluded to earlier, some of the societal issues, things that are in the air, things that you one might not be conscious of, but you may have read about back home or already have had some experience with. And one thing I want to say here is in 2020, President Pollock issued a statement in recognition of the historic racialized violence in the U.S., that it is clear that the university community must think and act holistically to change structures and systems that inherently privilege some more than others. I think at the same time, Cornell as an institution realizes that these ideas of freedom of expression, academic freedom, and sense of belonging are sometimes conflicting. And I think it's important for you all to know, if you don't know already, that this year's theme happens to be around this idea of freedom of expression. And the theme is the indispensable condition, freedom of expression at Cornell. So I think it's a really exciting time to be at Cornell in the US, given this theme. And so look out for a bunch of different topics and things that in sessions that will happen on campus to examine this theme.
One of the things that you may have heard when I introduced myself is that I use my pronouns. I said my name is Kim Garrison. I use she, her, and her pronouns. So gender inclusive pronouns are something we use a lot here. They certainly are not a requirement for you to introduce yourself using your pronouns. Some of the other pronouns that you may hear are also they, them, she, her, he, him, and there's a number of others that you may hear as well. To be tied into kind of connected to a student organization, we have a number of student organizations to support LGBTQ students. A few are listed here, right? Haven, the LGBTQ plus Graduate Association, as well as the Gender Justice Advocacy Coalition. We also like to talk about what offices can be there to support us as well. So within our Dean of Students office, we have a few centers that are able to support us, our Gender Equity Resource Center, as well as our LGBTQ Resource Center as well. One of the other pieces we wanted to talk about is Black Lives Matter, right? Talking through some aspects of police brutality that have happened throughout our country in different ways. And Black Lives Matter is really to eradicate white supremacy and build local power to intervene in violence inflicted on Black communities by state and other places, versus some of the other things that we may hear about All Lives Matter or other pieces. So racial inequities have really been a highlight of some things happening in the US around COVID, around, as I mentioned, some of the police brutality pieces, a number of other places. So, one of the kind of supports that we like to point to are student organizations, our Cornell for Black Lives, as well as Black Students United, right? And then our Black Student Empowerment Office, which is really evolving within our departments. And so something to be on the lookout for, as well as another resource and support.
So the last topic that we want to quickly touch on, and just as a disclaimer, we realize that this is a very short session and we could probably spend hours talking about each of one of these topics. So it's not to say these aren't important topics. We also want to recognize that you may have had experience with this, whether it's in your home countries in terms of social issues or your own experiences here in the US. The last topic here I just want to touch on for you all is anti-Asian racism. This is something that is embedded in the history of the US since the 19th century, but really came to a fore, to so to speak, during COVID-19, when Asians were in a way scapegoated and wrongly blamed for COVID-19. And it was around March 2020 where there was a tragic shooting in Atlanta. Six individuals that worked in spas were murdered, and that led to a national and a more increased consciousness in the idea of Asian fetishization. Another thing I want to bring up is this idea of the model minority that is kind of an underpinning this anti-Asian racism, to so to speak. And it's this idea that Asians in the US are successful. They're doing well. They don't need help. I know for me, I grew up in Connecticut, born and raised. My family's from China. Growing up, I actually was not good at math. But people really thought, hey, well, he's Asian. He should be good at math. It really kind of got in my head because I didn't think I could ask for help. I didn't think I should be struggling in math because I thought I was supposed to be good. That's what society was telling me. I think the last thing I want to say here, and this is adding on to what Kim was saying, there are places on campus where you can get support, where you can find community. So we've been talking about student organizations. I don't want to go into, there's so many student organizations. If there's one takeaway, have people heard of campus groups?
I love campus groups.
Oh, good. So campus groups, write that down. Remember, it's not on the slide, but campus groups is it's like a platform. This is the system. How do you describe it? It's basically where all the organizations on campus are listed, the over 1,000. You go on there, you go in the search menu, you type in keywords, you can find the different organizations. So can't emphasize it enough. Finding organizations, get involved in meeting new people, creates that community and kind of insulates one against some of the issues that are happening in society. The last thing is, this is cut off here. The support office actually happens to be my office, the Asian and Asian American Center. It's located on 626 Thurston in the building right next to the bridge near BB Lake. So I'm welcome to talking to any student or email me. I'm happy to give advice or just listen and hear what's going on in your lives. All right, the last thing to tie this all together is there's a couple more offices that are part of our area. The centers for Student Equity, Empowerment, and Belonging. We touched on the ones that are in Cornelian red, but the black ones, we have the first generation and low income student support office, which is being moved to Barnes Hall, which is not too far from Willard Strait Hall across the way. Then we have a new office called Latinx Student Empowerment. And then two more, the Office of Spirituality and Meaning Making that you can find in Annabelle Taylor Hall or Sage Chapel. And then last but not least, we have an undocumented and DACA student support area, which is also located in Barnes Hall.
The other piece we talk about is how we take care of ourselves, right? We talk a lot about how we take care of our physical health. And the other important, really important part is how we take care of our mental health as well. So as we've talked about here, once again, there's the support and resources that we continue to mention, right? Cornell has a lot of support here to be able to help us. We hope that we're over here in thriving in the green on the left all the time. And we recognize that sometimes life is stressful. Has life ever been stressful for anybody ever? No, just me sometimes, okay. There we go, we got some people who are like, yep, life has been stressful before. And we get over to this place where we're like, okay, I'm surviving, I'm doing it, it's stressful. But then when we get to these orange and red kind of columns on the right-hand side where I'm struggling or I feel like, oh my gosh, like I can't survive this. This is the point where we hope that you've reached out to somebody before you get to orange or red. But here's some of the ways that that might show up. We might not be sleeping well, right? Our human might hurt. Our body might have fatigue or aches or pain. We might be withdrawing from the humans who are important to us or the people who are important to us. Those are just some ways that that might show up. So when it starts to get to that surviving place, we hope that you call on some resources and some support to say, hey, I need some connection. I need to be in community with somebody and provide some of that support. So we'll talk a little bit more even about how we're here to help you.
So here, we just want to bring it back to this idea of connectedness and make you think that, some of you might think that, oh, academics is the only reason why I'm here at Cornell. I'm just going to focus on academics, work in my lab, teach, do my research, take my classes and study. But I think that's a trap. To just focus solely on your academics. I think having those connections, whether it's with peers, friends, professors, staff, are equally important. And it's actually research-based that fact that having those connections, being able to have peer support will help you in the same way that a winter jacket and a nice pair of boots will help you in the cold winter and the snowy days here. So think about that as a protective factor as you approach your studies here at Cornell. And then the last thing I'll say is many times people have told me that this is actually, I will come clean. This is my first full semester at Cornell. I started in March, but I've been told that Prepare is a great program, and this is an opportunity to make those connections. I've been told that people meet people here and their friends throughout their time here at Cornell. So think about the people that you're sitting next to. Think about the people that you might be meeting over a meal. This is the start of your network. I also know that working with an alumni group, I work with the Cornell Asian American Alumni Group, and these people are so passionate about each other. They still talk to each other. They graduated years ago. To me, what that speaks to is people really value the relationships and the connections they made at Cornell, and I really want to encourage you again to think in that way, that the people that you're meeting are going to be friends for a lifetime, and that's an important part of your experience here.
Some of the pieces that we want to, we talked a little bit about when we get to that oh no place or the place where we might be struggling and working through something, right? How do we reach out for help? So we wanted to provide you some actual support within that that is kind of built in. One of those pieces is our administrator on call process. So this is actually somebody that's available all night long if you need us, right? So we're not clinical, but we're really folks to be able to support students in distress in multiple ways. You can get a hold of us by contacting Cornell University Public Safety Communication Center at this number and just ask to be connected to an administrator on call. We'll call you back within just a few minutes. What are some of the ways that we can help? I'm so glad you asked. Great question. One is some of those academic consideration pieces. Sometimes when we're working through big deal things, we're like, oh no, I have this, I'm gonna pick something, this lab report due to my faculty member, my advisor tomorrow, right? But you didn't sleep all night long because you were working through something, or somebody may not be doing well at home, right? Any of those pieces. We're happy to reach out to your faculty and say, hey, this human is working through something and they might need some kind of support and some flexibility right now. Happy to also be supported in terms of connecting a student to student disability services. We'll talk more about student disability services in just a minute. Support following a transport. If we go to the hospital, right? That can be really helpful to figure out who we can be connected to and how, right? That takes a lot out of us sometimes in terms of like, we sometimes aren't sleeping very well and other things like that. We can provide support for student athletes and then continue to figure out ways that emergency funding might be applied. Sometimes we're like, that cost to go to the hospital, you know, might be on our minds. And what does that look like? And how does my health insurance work? And all those kind of pieces. We're not the office that really navigates all of that, but we're happy to pick up the phone and call and ask them and figure out what that is. Additional way that we're here is we actually have somebody that's available all day, every day, Monday through Friday, for you to just walk into our office or pick up the phone and call our office, drop-ins, whatever it is. If you need to be connected to somebody kind of in the same way, call Dean of the Day. And that's we'll tell you where our office is in just a second. And me, okay. I'm so excited about resources, is thinking through, as Huey said, there are so many campus organizations here to be able to support, over 1,000. If you don't find one that fits, you can also create your own. How cool is that, right? So we could have 1,001 because somebody in this room has an amazing idea that they want to create some support. The graduate school, right? Thinking about the Office of Inclusion and Student Engagement, the graduate school is somebody that we work with in our office all the time. The Ithaca community, what about this community that we live in, right? So certainly we live somewhere in Ithaca that might be on campus, that might be off campus, and we go to class or we go to our lab or whatever it is. But what else is happening in Ithaca can be really helpful. So this is a website that is like maintained and updated all the time. And then lastly, is thinking through Cornell Health. Cornell Health is also an amazing resource for folks. They can provide mental health care. They can also provide physical health care. They can provide connections to the community. They'll be able to answer health insurance questions and find that kind of connection to who in the community might work well with your insurance provider, different things like that. So Cornell Health is amazing. I was like open 5 days a week. So yeah. Where do you kind of go when you feel like you might be in crisis or in need of support, right? One of the pieces here is in the U.S., we've talked about that emotional well-being. How we take care of our mental health is also how we take care of our physical health in the same way. So about 20% of students here at Cornell do seek services underneath our counseling center, our counseling and psychological services. We call it CAPS for short, like capital letters, CAPS for short. And as we talk about here, there's 24/7 access to support. So they do have an after-hour service as well. Sometimes things are great from 8 to 5, and then at 2 o'clock in the morning, things are not great, right? Has anybody ever had like a 2 o'clock or 1 o'clock in the morning, like, oh goodness, I need some support, right? So that's there. And those are ways to be able to get a hold of both CAPS 24/7, as well as Cornell University Dispatch Center or Communication Center. So both of those are 24/7 support.
Thanks, Kim. So the final resource that we want to share, Kim already mentioned Student Disability Services. This is a very important resource on campus that works in partnership with faculty, students, and staff to make sure the academic life and student life are accessible, equitable, inclusive. I want to say that this office is thinks of disability is not just in medical terms, but in terms of it being a positive part of one's identity if one has a disability. So I think that's an important approach that not all disability offices look at when they think of students with disabilities. Then the last thing I want to say is that they support a wide range of students here on campus, whether you have a disability, have been diagnosed, or you want to talk to someone and you need to be diagnosed and you need services. So definitely encourage you all to consider this resource.
One of the other pieces that we'd love to kind of think about, we just threw a ton, metaphorically through, we shared verbally a ton of information with you that was also on the screen. So we'd love for you to find a connection, a partner, somebody near you. And we'd love for you to tell us or think through in that group, and a few people will report back to us, what are two things from our presentation that you want to remember leaving this session? So chat with a friend, we'll give you a minute or two. Two things you want to remember leaving our session.
Go.
A lot of contact us.
Okay. We'll have more people share. But maybe we're seeing a big time.
I think our contact info, like, find us if you have, like, non-dumb questions.
Okay. Yeah. I know we should have before.
Me? Okay. Hello, we're almost done. Ready? Can we bring it back? If you can hear me, can you raise your hand? If you can hear me, can you raise your hand? If you can hear me, can you raise your hand?
Hello, everyone.
If you can hear me, can you raise your hand? If you can hear me, can you raise your hand? If you can hear me, can you raise your hand? Awesome, thank you so much. Feel free to put your hand down. We'd love, I know you kind of expected this, for somebody or a few people to share with us what you all chatted about. Maybe a few snapshots.
And we'll pass around the mic so everyone can hear you.
Volunteers, anybody? Yes.
Just sharing what you've spoke about. Two things you learned. Do you want to share?
Yeah. So I came really unprepared in the sense I literally had no idea of how big Cornell is and everything. So I think the Visiting Ithaca website is something that I'm looking forward to explore and then see what I want to explore further.
sorry.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Yes, thank you for sharing with this information. I was connected with Cornell because my professor was studied here, and he recommended this university as it's one of the prestigious and the Ivy League university. So yeah, and I'm really excited with environment, with this vibe. It's very, very interesting. Yeah.
Thank you for sharing. Anyone else want to share with two things they took away from today's session that Kim and I presented?
Hello, everyone. I just want to share with you my own experience from last year that I was studying abroad for the first time, and I was completely from different country, different culture, and it was so hard for me to adjust with new culture, people, everything. And I was struggling with finding friends, everything. And then I found out joining to clubs and joining to their invitation and every programs that university has is very helpful. And then also, as you mentioned it, prioritize your mental health and wellness as well, which is the most important thing for you during that journey. Yeah, thank you so much.
You need to present next year. Yes. I think we saw a hand over here in the white hat. Thank you so much.
Hi, I just came here a week ago, had 36 flights, 36 hours flights and layover. And it is my first time living outside my country. So it's a huge deal for me. And also I'm very, very nervous. I will start the school tomorrow after 6 years of my undergrad graduation. I think your session is really helpful for me. And two things that I want to remember is that reach out before it gets worse, and that you're not alone in this journey. You have such a very helpful community, advisors, faculty, you guys here, and that are two things that I want to remember. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That's amazing. Yes, please call us anytime. Mm-hmm. That's awesome. Yep. Up to you.
All right. So thank you all for your attention. It's been a pleasure presenting to you all. Just as a final note, we will be sharing this presentation with Lauren and Brandon and Margaret. And so it'll be sent out to everyone so you don't have to have memorized everything. So in the presentation, you'll see both of our emails. My email's cut off, but you can see Kim's there. So feel free to reach out to either one of us.
I have one more thing, if sure. I may, for the group. The other thing that I might, hopefully I don't put Huey on the spot here. I would like to say for both of us and the humans that we work with, the people that we work with, we want you to know that no question is a dumb question. So if you need somebody to be I have a question and I don't know if I should ask this or anything like that, I will open my office up to that as well as my email inbox to schedule a meeting to hey, I just don't know if this is a question I can ask or where I should go or where I should start or any of those things. So please know that we are resources kind of in that mix as well.
Yes, me too.
You
too.
Sounds good. Thank you. We'll turn it back over to our friends. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Huey. Thank you so much, Kim. Really appreciate all the information. Thank you very much. So, one thing first, we have one more brief presentation, then we'll have some of our panelists come up, and after that we'll be going into reception. I'll provide further instructions when it's time to do that. So that's number one. Number two, I want to do something with you all just briefly. So it sounds like many of you either flew here or maybe you drove here, but especially if you flew here, you know how uncomfortable it is to be on a plane. And you know, just once in a while, you have to just kind of stand up and lift up your arms. And that's all you can pretty much do. So you sit back down and suffer for another, you know, 5 hours. So what I want everyone to do, if you're able to, is to do just like I did. On the count of three, you're going to stand up, put your arms up and go, ah, I want to hear you, okay? Or make whatever sound is natural for you when you do that, okay? Okay, so on the count of three, but you have to stand up, so that's one, two, three. Ah, there we go. All right, wow, this is really beautiful to see all the different facial expressions and body movements. So everybody sit down. Now, I want to do one more thing with you all. It's called the wave. All right? And you've probably seen this, probably know what this is, but I'm going to walk across the stage, and as I walk across, I want you to stand up and then sit back down. And I'm going to go back and forth two or three dozen times, okay? So everybody is gonna be here, is gonna start on this side. So you're gonna stand up and then sit back down. And I'm gonna go like this. I'll probably have to run. And then I'm gonna go back in the other direction. So I wanna see a nice wave going back and forth, okay? Everybody ready on this side? I'm counting on you. You're starting it off. Okay, one, two, three. I need to hear you. Okay, keep going. Back. There we go. Don't you feel so much better now? I've never seen that happen on a plane back and forth, but I think there's got to be some flight attendant who's done it once or twice. So thank you all very, very much. We are now ready for our next speaker. I'd like to bring up to the stage Michelle Crowe to tell us about ELSO, the English Language Support Office. Michelle.
Into this mic.
Hello, everybody. I'm so glad to see you here today. I'm here to welcome you to Cornell on behalf of the English Language Support Office, which is called ELSO. That's the acronym we use, ELSO, E-L-S-O. And I'm here to welcome you on behalf of my office, which also includes Nathan Lindberg and Melissa Myers. Okay, if you get one message from my brief presentation today, it's that we are here for you. Okay. We love working with international graduate students, and our office is dedicated to working with you. You can email us with any question at elso@cornell.edu. You're also welcome to drop by our office, which is in Caldwell Hall, which is on the Ag Quad near Mann Library. Our mission is to provide writing and speaking support to multilingual graduate and professional students in diverse programs, from diverse language backgrounds, and at diverse points in their graduate careers. So we work with students from all of the different colleges and schools and degree programs here at Cornell, from all over the world with different language backgrounds, from their first semester all the way to their fourth year, fifth year, sixth year, seventh year. As long as you are here at Cornell, we are here to work with you. We offer a number of different programs. I'm going to give just a very brief overview. And we offer half semester courses. These are credit bearing courses, 1.5 credits. They're pass fail. And I'm going to talk more about them in a minute. We offer peer tutoring programs. And so you can bring a paper, you can bring a presentation to one of our peer tutors. You can also meet with one of our peer tutors to work on pronunciation. We have a workshop series. So the faculty in ELSO give 90-minute workshops on different topics throughout the semester. We offer six a semester. The first one is on September 8th, and you can't see it here, but it's called Preparing for University Career Days, which is the great big career fair of the year. It comes up very early in the semester. So our first workshop is to help students prepare for that. We have a speaking groups program. This is a program where students meet in small groups, about five or six students, with a volunteer from the Cornell community to practice social English, also to have fun and to make friends. We have summer writing support. We offer a program called Write Together at Home, where students meet in writing groups, they meet for write-ins, and they get tutoring. It's a great way to make progress on your writing during the summer. And we have a Canvas site and a listserv. Everyone gets automatically enrolled into our listserv. The Canvas site is something that's program-wide. We put all of the different materials that we create into this Canvas site, and anybody can self-enroll. So there's a lot of great stuff there for you to explore. I want to spend just a couple of minutes talking about courses because class starts tomorrow. How did that happen so quickly, huh? It's just amazing. And so we offer four different writing courses. These are all courses designed to support the writing that you are doing already. We don't give you writing assignments in these courses. Like, I'm not going to ask you to write an essay for me. Instead, I'm going to teach you strategies and give you support so that you can make progress on writing that you're doing for your courses, for your dissertation, for your thesis, for articles that you're working on for publication, application materials, anything that you happen to be working on. And these courses all have the word workshop in them because you're given time during class to work on your writing, okay? These courses all have an application process, and so you can go to our website and find the application link. And it's a really brief little application where you tell us your goals for taking that course, and then we make sure that course is the right fit for you. We offer three different speaking courses: improving pronunciation, taking part in discussions, designing and delivering presentations. All of these courses are highly interactive, and they give you a lot of different strategies and resources to keep working in these areas. We offer three different courses that we call professional communication. These are courses that integrate writing and speaking, communicating in the workplace, preparing for the professional job search, and preparing for the academic job search. Communicating in the workplace and preparing for the professional job search are both offered in fall, and preparing for the academic job search is offered in the spring. Okay, and so some of these courses are full right now. And so if you go to Student Center and try to enroll, they won't appear. And that's because it's reached its cap of 12. And so to see those courses, what you need to do is unclick this default button, and then you'll be able to see them. If a course is full and you're interested in the course, don't give up. So lots of students change their schedules at the beginning of the semester. And so keep trying, keep going to Student Center and see if a spot opens, but you can also join our wait list. For a course that has an application, to join the wait list, you fill out an application. For the other courses, email us at elso@cornell.edu. We always add the first three students from the wait list into a course. And so we allow our courses to go up to 15 and sometimes even a little bit higher because we know student schedules are going to change and we want to make sure as many students as possible have an opportunity to get into the courses. Okay. And so if you have any questions, please email us, elso@cornell.edu, drop by. We always have somebody there Monday through Thursday from 9 to about 4:30. Explore our website, lots of information there, and please join our Canvas site. So thank you all very, very much. I have a wonderful start to your year and your degree program here at Cornell. And I'm leaving brochures out right outside the door here. So if you want to remember some of the stuff that you learned today, you can grab this as you go out the door.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Michelle. We are going to go ahead and move now to our final segment before our reception. We have several students here that we've asked to serve as panelists so that we can ask a few questions that I already have written down, and also some of the questions that you all sent us in advance of this orientation. So if I could ask for Kai, Bo, and Pankaj to please come up onto the stage and take a seat. Everyone, if you give a round of applause for our panelists. So give me just 1 second while I let them know how things will work with the mic. So I believe the microphones are on. Pankaj, could you check to see if your mic is working? Yep, I think so. And then Bo, do you want to make sure that that mic's working? Perfect. Okay, so what we're going to go ahead and do first, if you just want to take a moment to introduce yourselves, you know, your full name, maybe home country, what you are studying or what you studied here at Cornell, and then we'll go into some of our questions. So maybe Pankaj, do you want to start?
Yeah, so I'm Pankaj Singh. I'm originally from India.
Sorry, I forgot to say nice and close, they're telling us with the mics.
Good now?
Even closer.
Oh, okay. So my name is Pankaj Singh, and I'm from India originally, and I studied mechanical and aerospace engineering. So I finished my PhD in 2017, and now I work in the area. That's all me.
My name is Kai. I am from the law school. I'm doing the JSD, Doctor of the Science of Law degree program, the law school. Originally, I'm from China, and previously I did my LLM degree from the law school, which is the Master of Law degree.
Hi, my name is Bo. I'm a fourth year PhD student in food science. I'm from Thailand.
There we go. Thank you everyone so much for being here. Like I said, I have some questions that I've made up. We also have some questions from the registration, and then we'll wait a couple of minutes and then we'll also take maybe other questions from the room. Does that sound okay? Great. For these questions, if you have something to say, you can say it. If you don't have something to say, don't feel like you have to add anything, okay? So maybe a first question from our registration: how do I make the most of my time at Cornell? What do you do? What did you do to make the most of your time here? Or did you not do, or are you not doing, to make the most of your time?
I can.
And you do
I
not need to
first.
Go in order. Jump on in
first. Okay. So I can answer first. So my answer is very simple, which is to do my research. And I'm going to let you know why. So I'm here in 2018 as a member of the law school master degree program because I wanted to be a legal scholar for the purpose of teaching in the law school after graduation, which requires a JSD or PhD in law degree from the US or any other jurisdictions worldwide. So in the American legal industry or legal education system, it is very important to have a good GPA, to have a good writing, and especially considering the fact that we only have 1 year of master degree program, there's only one chance of the possibility of having the possibility of being considered as a possible candidate for this PhD or doctoral program in law. And it's also very important to have a great relationship with the professors who will possibly be the advisor in the future. So when I was a student at the master degree program, I took like 30 credits for a year, wrote a lot of papers, and I made a lot of friends who had the same goal in the law school. So my simple answer is just to study.
Sure. So for me, it would be to try to hang out with people from other countries, because I know that as an international student, especially from big countries, sometimes you tend to look for the first people that are similar to you and then hang on to them to the rest of the year, which is okay sometimes, but it's also important to like meet people from other countries. My other point is to go to conferences, try to do that every summer as soon as you have like results or papers to present, because going to conference really gives you the opportunity to meet people from the same field but from other schools, and also people from the industry, and that's really inspiring.
I will piggyback on Bo's answer. And I think as a graduate student, every Friday, we used to go to Big Red Barn for the happy hour. So that was a good networking event as a grad student. I also tried to take at least one day on the weekend off and not do any research, just to take it, just have it for myself. So that's what I did with my free time.
Great, well, thank you all for that insight. Conflicting insight, I'll admit, between the studying and the time off, but you have to do it all, right? And I think the takeaway is, of course, finding balance, use all of these resources that you have available to you. The next question that I would have, talking a bit about academic life here, maybe, you know, what surprised you about academic life here? Or, you know, things that maybe took some time for you to get used to, maybe differences from back home or otherwise.
Yeah, I can answer that. So I think something which was different for me was that the academic support is accessible to you is a lot compared to what I was used to. So having access to office hours, being able to go and talk to your professors and just emailing them and making an appointment, like accessibility to different resources had been very helpful to me in the past.
So I think to me, what was very surprising was that having a great accomplishment academically at Cornell University would definitely provide a lot of platform, access to a lot of great platforms, not just what you possibly have already imagined. So to me, I've spent a few years here so far as a doctoral student. And for this summer, I was working for the International Monetary Fund legal department. And for the last summer, I worked for the Asian Development Financial Integrity Office. And before that, I also worked for the United Nations Security Council as an intern. And all of these were based on my study, the outcome of my study, and the connection I established at Cornell Law School, especially my professors and supervisors. So I have to say congratulations for coming to Cornell, and you have a lot of possibility, but you have to be very, very clear about what is your goal and understand what is expectation from the people in the place you wanna go. It is really important for you to start, think about and start building your relationship and look for a job from now.
That's the difficult one to follow up on. for me, maybe this is just my experience and in my program, but I found that the learning environment here sometimes is so relaxed. It's okay to make mistakes. professor asks a question, you answered it. The professor may disagree or they say that you're wrong, but then everyone move on and it's fine. And the other thing that was surprising to me, which is kind of too late now, is that in the US, I learned that you don't need to have a master to apply for a PhD program. So yeah, make sure to, you know, tell your friends that too, like the people who may be interested but don't have a master degree.
So one thing that we hear from international students that's maybe a transition for them to academic life in the United States, you already touched on this a little bit in terms of maybe asking questions, seeking help. Sometimes students might be used to a more formal kind of academic environment where maybe the engagement with the professor, you know, is less, or it's maybe just after class. You know, the idea of maybe going to office hours might be something new. Also maybe how you're communicating with, you know, other students in the class. And is that maybe a more competitive environment or more of a collaborative environment? Any comments there? Did you find anything about Cornell that was maybe more, let's say, relaxed or more casual than you were used to?
I would say, so you have talked about the context of talking to professors. So I would respond in this context. So the simple answer is, it is okay to make a mistake. And this was really something relaxing for me, because previously, before coming to Cornell, I always had the assumption that I cannot make any mistake in or outside of the classroom, including the office hour with professors or even casual chats with professor in restaurant. But here, as long as the learning process and is great, as long as demonstrating a great attitude for the pursuit of new knowledges, it is okay to make a mistake. But also, the way to make mistake is really important. For example, we talk about the context of office hour for professors. It is really important to have to prepare a good questions. So by means of that, for me, my personal experience was every time I go to professor's office hour, I always prepare a writing, 2 pages or 3 pages, summarizing my thinking and in bullet points, and provide a very clear 3 or 4 questions and tell him or her what I want to discuss, how long I want to discuss, and what is expected outcome, so that it is possible to make this process easier for me and for the professor. So I think that's really different and that's really relaxing.
I agree with you. And like the number of like take home exams, or sometimes we were allowed to redo our assignments even after they have been graded. Like that flexibility was something really new for me. And it really helped me to not to just focus on the score, but to actually learn what I did in the assignment or the exam.
Well, I want to now give a moment to allow anyone from the audience. I have more questions, but I want to give a chance for people from the audience to ask questions as well. Anyone have any thing that you'd like to ask our panel about? And I'll come walk down and I can pass you the mic. Go ahead and raise your hand if you want me to come by.
Another takeaway is that in the US, no questions are silly questions. You can ask anything.
So now's your chance. Well, I'll let you keep thinking about questions. Moving away from academics for a moment, I want to talk about maybe life just in the United States. What was that like for you maybe within that first year? And what are some recommendations that you have for new students on, you know, not just maybe how to adapt, but maybe the mentality to adapt as they're transitioning into life here?
My recommendation is to step out of the comfort zone and try to interact with people who share the same background with you. So that is something that a lot of people hesitate. But yeah, I think stepping out of the comfort zone and try to do that would really help in the long run.
Enjoy what Ithaca has to offer. We have beautiful natures. I know that a lot of you may be from a city and find Ithaca miserable. Sometimes it could be, but in a few months, it's gonna be very pretty. The leaves are changing colors. You know, go out on a hike with some friends, kayak if you like the waters. And I hope you find some beauty in Ithaca. Be open-minded.
Well, there are a lot of possibilities for you, for all of you, during and after graduation, but you have to find one. You have to decide one as early as possible. And finding out what is the expectation, and then building your supporting group in the first year as early as possible. When I was here in my first year, assuming all of you understand the intensity of study at the law school, it was very difficult for me to even understand the professor's lecture at the first 2 weeks and to complete note-taking process after each of the classes and finish the reading process. So I was very lucky to find out a lot of JD students who were able to share with me their insight and help me to understand what I couldn't understand. So in summary, find out your goal and find out the people who is going to support you.
And so I think that's another message that's coming through clearly. Again, take advantage of those resources. Those might be peer groups that might be working with your faculty, your professors, either during class asking questions, maybe going after class or in office hours, and then utilizing the resources that we've talked about today and many more. One thing that came up, Kai, that you talked about maybe has to do with language, and that for some people coming in, you know, taking their courses and doing research in English might not be a challenge for them, or it might be more of a dialect difference that they have to get used to, or for some that might be a big, a barrier that they might be worried about. Any thoughts on that, either, you know, if you have personal experience or experience with, you know, friends or others, how to navigate that, resources to utilize?
So we have to be realistic. So I assume some of you have some questions or question yourself about your ability to speak or to write or read English, right? But we have to be realistic. We have to understand what is tested as a student or as an employee or whatever you define it, right? For example, at the law school, what is most important is the ability to read and to write. So in that context, for me, it was very important to find out at least 3 or 5 papers that's written by students or by professors, and then see the style of their writing, right? In terms of reading, so at the beginning, I was not able to read very fast, right? But after a few weeks, I started to realize that a lot of information are unnecessary in the class. What is going to be tested in the class has been very, very focused on, for example, in legal cases, the fact patterns and the holding, the thinking process by the judges, right? So that's very important. Well, it is very important to talk to people and to improve your general English skill, but we have to be realistic to understand what's most important among your time. So all of us have limited time. That's equal to all of us. So make use of your time as better as possible for your personal needs.
And for like day-to-day life, I'm just gonna go back to my original point of finding friends from different cultures, people that don't speak the same language as you. So when you hang out, you're forced to use English. That works too.
Yeah, and also try to take advantage of different English support groups on campus. Yeah, ELSO is one of them, and they do offer courses. So if you do feel like you want to improve some of your like spoken or like written English, seek out their support.
So now we've talked some about the academic life. We've talked some about, you know, maybe life in the United States. Continue, of course, audience, to think of questions that you might have for the panel. Another piece that I wanted to talk about was, and some of you have gotten to this in different ways, you know, kind of job prospects, right? The professional component. So it sounds like maybe Kai, you have experience, you know, having working opportunities kind of throughout, you know, your academic career so far. Could you all talk about maybe, you know, what you've been doing, what resources have worked well for you to both be thinking about maybe your career development and maybe also in terms of identifying options, how that path went for you while you were a student or as you are currently a student?
Yeah, I can answer that question. Like so far, since I graduated from Cornell, I've had two job offers, and both of the job offers actually came through Cornell alumni. So I was lucky enough to connect with them during the career fair, or outside of the career fair, I was able to connect with some friends. So that's how I have been able to get the jobs that I'm in right now. And apart from that, I started a company while I was a student, and that was also along with my friends who were at Cornell. So yeah, like Cornell network will really help you in finding jobs after you graduate. So networking obviously like paid more emphasis to that.
So it's of course networking is very important. In addition to that, I think it's very important to find out one or two areas where you are the best one, or you want to be the best one, at least in your network or in the industry. So how to do that? It's very important to have a good test. So this is a very vague term, but whatever happens in the industry, you can monitor whatever happens every week, every day, through new sources, open new sources, or talk to people who used to graduate from Cornell or who are interesting from your perspective, right? So, and then to write, in our cases, in the legal industry, it's very important to have at least one publication. So this publication will help you to land a great job. It is very important to have a good CV. It's very important to have a good GPA, or take a great classes, or having great connections. But what is unique to you? This is very important, right? People is not gonna remember you based on your name or your, or possibly your own based on your name. But what's most important is what you are good at. So can you, for example, in a job interview, after finish all the behavior question, can you just get the job done right away, right? They give you a very substantive question. Can you just handle it? That's very important. That's the key skill. So of course, a lot of big companies are willing to teach you after you start your job, but why don't you take your initiative to learn on yourself during your academic life at Cornell and be the one among your cohort that can be the first one to find out the great resources, right? So I think that's important.
And to add to that, we're lucky to be at Cornell. They have fantastic career services. So make sure you take advantage of those. They can help you with pretty much anything career related, resume building, cover letter writing, mock interviews. Yeah.
Another question that came from our registrants had to do with your relationship with your advisor, right? So in your cases, if you know, you have an advisor and you've developed a relationship with them, could you talk about, you know, what that relationship is like and maybe anything that's worked for you in terms of developing that relationship or any challenges that you might be able to share?
I can answer that. So for me, I'm in STEM and I do research and when I entered the program, right, I didn't know what project I was supposed to work on. And took me a while because I was kind of like waiting to be told what I'm supposed to be doing or working on. And I realized that that's a wrong approach. When you have like an advisor, usually these people are very busy. They don't just manage the lab, but they have other things to work on. So what you can do is to manage up, meaning that you would have to kind of tell them what you need them to do for you. And yeah, I think that's very important.
Yeah, I think, yeah, I agree with you, Bo. Like when I started my graduate program, I did not know what was the right question to ask in your research. And that's something that my advisor really helped me throughout my time, like asking the right question, because once you ask the right question, you are smart enough already to answer it. But yeah, having to be on good terms with your advisor and have that relationship that they actually help you grow into a researcher, at least for as a PhD student, that was really helpful for me to be able to become an individual independent thinker.
I think it's very important to understand the expectation from the advisor and to understand what you really want from what kind of help you want from your advisor. So if the expectation from the advisor and your own expectation does not match very perfectly, then find out a way to make sure that it can work out, right? So I call this as being professional. But being professional, from my perspective, has two dimensions. The first dimension is to be very confident, right? We are students, we can make mistakes, but we have to be confident. Even if we make mistakes, we have to be very confident to accept it and to work it out under the help of the advisor, right? So that's very important. First is be confident, right? And then second is to demonstrate your potentiality to become a profession, whether or not in the industry or in the academic settings, right? So how to do that? You have to make sure that you have great insight. You know what area is important, what is needed in the industry, and what kind of effort you need to make, right? And what is going to be your strengths and weaknesses, right? So that's very important. And overall, advisors are our advisors, that they are very important. If you want to make a long-term relationship, long-term work relationship with the advisors, this is the beginning. This is not the end. So the last thing is prepare to make sure that you can establish more longer-term perspective, right? Not just the 1 year or 2 years or only the 5 years as PhD students. That's really important from my perspective. I'm sure both of you agree with what I say.
So again, I want to pause for a minute and see if there are any questions from the audience, anything that you've heard so far that you want to follow up on. Yeah, give me 1 second and I'll pass you the mic.
First of all, thank you for the great energy and amazing information so far. So my question is for the panelist on the left. So I would just like to ask, So I would just like to ask, how did you navigate running a company as an international student? So.
International Students Office really helped me guide through the immigration process. So that's something you should seek out their help for.
Through the immigration office?
Yeah.
Okay, so do we need an OPT or something like that for?
I seek help for getting a CPT, which was, as a student, I was able to work part-time in the startup.
Thank you.
And I should say, and now I'm forgetting if we'll have this in the fall or in the spring, but there will, we started doing now an immigration session specifically focused on entrepreneurship. That's been popular. So we have other sessions focused on, you know, visas after graduation and working after graduation. But we've recently started a session on entrepreneurship. So thank you. Any other questions from the audience? Yeah, I mean, run back.
Hello. Did you find any opportunities to hang out or network with students in other programs, other colleges here at Cornell that are not necessarily in your classes or in your college?
I can answer. So you can take classes anywhere on Cornell campus. So I was actually able to take classes in different schools other than engineering schools. So that's a good way to connect with people who are not, who do not share the same academic background as you.
Yeah, if reading publication by students from other department and just contact them by email or by whatever means and talk about, talk about my question about the publication. That's my way of reaching out to other students from other departments.
And if you like outdoor activities, I know that Cornell has this kind of like outdoor group where they go to different places and hike and kayak or whatever. And I heard it's a great place to meet people from other programs and including American students as well.
Thank you all. Other questions from the audience? Bring two in the back and then I'll be right back.
So how do you manage staying in touch with your loved ones at home, particularly with time differences? Do you have any tips for that?
I do, yeah. Like I share a time difference of almost 10 and a half hours right now with my family. So I need to call them every day. That's one thing I do. And have them come over here and see how you live, where you live. That's one great way to actually keep connected with your family.
Yeah, just text or call family members, but make sure to really understand what kind of information you want to express to your family member. Do you want to tell them only good news? Or do you want to tell them your sadness so that they are going to be sad as well? So you got, all of us are adults, right? So it's really important to make sure that you understand what you want to say.
I mean, it really depends on your family dynamic, but yeah, try. We're lucky to have internet now, so keeping in touch is not as difficult as it is in the past. Yeah, I don't really have anything to add, just like frequent communication. Yeah, if you can't call them, at least like, I don't know, send photos or something. Parents love photos.
Thank you all. Thank you. So I have another question.
Hello all. I have a question for Pankaj. I'd like to ask, like, as we celebrate Navratri and Diwali and all of that festivals in India, do we have any Navratri festival in Cornell as well?
Yeah, I think there's an organization called CIA, Cornell Indian Student Association. So, yeah, so I'm not really up to date on like how to connect with them, but that's one of student organization which is specifically run by graduate students, and there is another one which is at undergrad level. So they both organize their own events. And now since I graduated out from the school, I actually am aware of organizations which are run by like the Indian community in this area as well. So there are multiple groups of Indian community who organizes.
Yeah, and I would just maybe add to that in a more general sense, when we'll send out information to everyone for all the attendees, everyone that registered, we'll add some other information so you can identify the links to find those different student organizations. And you can go on, you know, their Instagram or Facebook, and you can see what they have posted for the coming months. Other questions? These are great.
Hi, I totally agree that we need to find out where we can be very professional, like in the industry or in the academic path. So it seems like you have a very determined goal of pursuing a PhD degree. So that means to take a academic path. So how can we know that whether or not we are suitable for the industry or the academic path? So how can we find out our strength or weakness? Thank you.
Yeah, sure, I will go first. It depends on what kind of industry you're talking about. For example, I'm from the law school. So in the law school, being a lawyer or being a judge or prosecutor or professors are different types of career paths, but professors make publications and judges make publications. Lawyers even make publications, come back to Cornell Law School to teach. So in that context, in the law school, what I think is very important is to think about what kind of stimulus you want to receive from outside, right? Being a lawyer means you receive tons of new information, meet with tons of new different people. They need your service, you are a service provider. So you have to make sure that people around you are not necessarily people who understand the law. So the information you see from outside might be something that for you, it's a little bit weird, right? People may possibly do not understand what you are talking about. In the law school or as a judge, you possibly do not have to face with this kind of problem. In the law school, you are a professor or a lecturer or students or postdoc, whatever it is, people have get legal training so far. So I think that's a huge difference. And the second is, based on this kind of distinction, do you enjoy doing research? Can you really sit down there, close your phone for 7 days, never touch your phone, just to go into the law library to do research and to finish the whole process of writing, for example, 40 pages for law review paper, and to change whatever happens in the next 12 months based on the information happened in the court system or in the industry, right? And this is going to be a long process, but the inference is huge as well, right? Being a lawyer means your value is determined not only by the quality, but also by the quantity of your time. But being a judge or being a professor means your contribution might depend on the quality of your paper or your work instead of the quantity, right, of your work. And the last thing is, what kind of life do you want to have in 20 years or in 30 years? Being a lawyer in the context of my industry means having a very busy life, possibly spend 10 hours at minimum every day, no weekends, to find out good clients, new clients consistently, right? But being a professor means you have the freedom to think about the question happening in the industry, only like spend a few hours engaging or teaching with students, and then you can simply focus on your publications, right? So I answer the question based on three different dimensions. I'm not an expert in other area, so I can only tell you my experiences in my area, but I think you can get useful information from my answer to your question, hopefully. Thank you.
Yeah, I would recommend pursuing an internship. If you're a PhD student, you have enough time in grad school that you can actually obtain an internship and experience work in the industry. Like how is research applied in industry? And I decided to pursue industry job after my PhD degree because academia is more focused on intellectual curiosity. And for me, when I was in the industry, I saw like whatever I did out of intellectual curiosity right away went into implementation. And that was something that was a good part for me to see like what I did is actually being used out in the real world right now. So seeing that application coming into action was something important to me, and that's why I chose to stick into it in industry.
For me, I'm also kind of in the process of figuring that out myself. I think I'm leaning towards industry now, but my advice for you would be try to talk to a lot of people when you have a chance? Like if there's like a networking event in your program where they invite like alumni, go to the people that had a PhD or maybe went to industry, ask them why they chose to do that. Going to conferences also help. And while at Cornell, when is the time to decide which path to go, kind of keep your advisor updated on about your progress, and maybe they can also help you, help guide you.
Well, I think with that, we're going to go ahead and, Yeah.
Thank you. So I had one comment, and then I wanted to ask one question that's maybe the most important question. But my one comment is that many of you probably came here to work with a specific professor, and that's great. Hopefully you will make connections with that advisor, and that will be a good relationship. Sometimes you'll come and you'll find that you're more interested in a different field, or you have a learning style that is more of a connection to somebody else. And I just want to say that I feel I've heard that it can, I know it's very hard to change advisors or to think about switching. And I think sometimes there's more reluctance among international students for reasons connected to how difficult it is to come here and how far away you are, maybe from other networks or support groups. But just know that you can talk to other people in the department. There is someone you can go to, a department manager or the chair of the department, have that conversation. It's not about who's right and who's wrong. It can be about different kinds of styles. And you want to make sure that you get the most out of your education and you do the work that is the most meaningful and in the best way for you. So we've increasingly tried to do things like rotations and getting exposure to other classes so that people really do make the best fit for them in graduate school. So the most important question that you haven't touched on is, what is your favorite restaurant in Ithaca?
There are too many options.
I know one. I like spicy food, so I like going to the Tasty in College Town. It has Sichuan food and hot pot. It's great.
Lev's Kitchen on Commons. That's a good one.
The buffet in Stud Hotel. I had a lot of buffet lunch or dinner with professors and possibly some conference attendee coming to Cornell, and that was the best place for me. I think the second floor of Stutter Hotel.
Oh. Fee.
So the band fee. The band
Godfrey,
fee is
good
the name.
Dessert, yeah.
Well, could I get a round of applause for our panelists? Thank you all very much. So what we're now going to do, well, number one, thank you all so much for attending this part of the event. We're gonna, in just a moment, I'll give some instructions. We'll go out into the hallway, and then out to the hallway to my right, we have refreshments, so snacks and desserts. There's, you know, water, lemonade. This is to give you all a chance just to get to know each other, to meet other people, you know, so please take advantage of that. Be in touch with my office, anything that we can do to help you. We will be in touch with all of you with what we've covered today and all those resources. So thank you all, and we'll see you outside in just a moment. Thank you.